Question is often asked, why do bad things happen to good people? Now, I think really the first thing that needs to be asked about that question is this: who is a good person? Because Romans 3:12 says, all have turned away, they have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. So I think probably the better question than why do bad things happen to good people would be, why do bad things happen to God's people? I think that's a much more appropriate question, because there are no good people. Not only Romans said that, but Jesus said that too in the Gospels. So we're not good people. I hate to break that to you this morning, but it's not my opinion of you. I think you're just the most wonderful people I've ever met in my life. Every one of you, you're just so special, all of you. But the Bible's opinion of you is you're not good, not even one of you. But if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, you can be considered one of God's people. And the Bible says that we are a chosen people, royal priests, a holy nation, God's very own possession. Wow. And the truth is that even God's people aren't immune to pain and suffering. Bad things do happen to God's people. On the surface, it seems to be a conundrum or even a contradiction. If God is good, boy, you're slow today. I mean, I'm even doing the hand signals and all that stuff. If God is good, yeah. And if he is all powerful, and he is, then it would seem to make sense that he would use his good power to prevent bad things from happening to people, especially to his people, to God's people. But we all know that's not the case. Christians get shot by crazy gunmen and all this mad violence going on in our country, just like non-Christians do. Christians get cancer and heart disease, just like agnostics or atheists do. You see, I think deep down inside us, because we think logically, we know we should think spiritually, but for the most part, we think logically. We're human. We think with our background, our past and our backgrounds affecting every one of our thoughts. I think most of us are drawn deep down inside to the false assumption that if we're good and we say our prayers and we pay our taxes and we're nice to people and we keep Ten Commandments, that good things should happen to us and our loved ones and no bad things should happen to them. It's sort of like an old Seinfeld episode I saw a month or so ago when preparing for this message, where Kramer keeps saying, even Steven, Jerry, it all balances out, even Steven. Jerry loses a job and then gets a phone call 5 minutes later offering him another job for the same money, even Steven, Jerry. Jerry misses his favorite TV show, but then he is able to catch the rerun, even Steven. Elaine throws $20 of Jerry's money out the window, taunting him that even Steven could be true. And a few minutes later, Jerry reaches in his pocket and finds a $20 bill he didn't know he had. And Kramer's eyes get big and he goes, even Steven, Jerry. It all balances out. But listen, that's just TV. And there is no such thing as reality TV. There is no such thing as reality TV. There are people standing around with hundreds of cameras, you know. Those people aren't out there on an island by themselves, isolated. There are people all around them. But God never promised that life would balance out. Philip Yancey wrote a great book about dealing with adversity entitled Disappointment with God, and in it he wrote these words: "Is life fair? Read the story of Jesus and ask yourself, was life fair to him? The cross has demolished for all time the basic assumption that life will be fair." I've said it many times, life isn't fair, but God is good
all the time.
And all the time. Now, in this passage in 2 Corinthians, Paul writes about a time when life wasn't being good for him. He writes about a time of suffering that he had not brought on himself. Satan, as we just sang, "Rescue me from the wicked," Satan had brought it on him, or others had. Nevertheless, he brings some good thoughts for us about dealing with our suffering and our pain, or when bad things happen to God's people. And so, continuing this theme of preaching on the book that is our Love Your Bible book that week, we're in 2 Corinthians, and I'm reading from chapter 1, verse 8. "We think you ought to know, dear brothers and sisters, about the trouble we went through in the province of Asia. We were crushed and overwhelmed beyond our ability to endure. And we thought we would never live through it. In fact, we expected to die. But as a result, we stopped relying on ourselves and learned to rely only on God, who raises the dead. And he did rescue us from mortal danger, and he will rescue us again. And we have placed our confidence in him, and he will continue to rescue us. And you are helping us by praying for us. Then many people will give thanks because God has graciously answered so many prayers for our safety. I don't have to convince you that bad things do happen to God's people." Some of you are going through them right this very moment. "Like Paul, we all have the scars, inside or outside, to prove that. But I do want us to consider the question, why? What is the purpose behind the pain? Is it just random? Is it just bad luck? What is the purpose behind the pain?" And Paul said the first purpose is to help us focus on what really matters. We were crushed and overwhelmed and beyond our ability to endure, and we thought we would never live through it. Now, we don't know exactly what hardship in Asia Paul was referring to. He could have been referring to several. He could have been referring to what happened to Lystra, to him in Lystra, which is recorded in Acts chapter 14, where he was stoned and left for dead by a mob that had attacked him. They dragged Paul outside the city and pelted his body with stones until they thought he was dead. And who knows, maybe he was, but for whatever reason, miraculously he got back up and was fine. They left him bleeding and unconscious, and before long he was back preaching the gospel. Later, when the disciples came to pray for Paul, he recovered and he was right back in the city praying just like he always did. When you're being stoned to death, unimportant issues seem to sort of fade away, don't you think? I mean, after you get a doctor's report that you have a malignancy, you're not going to be too upset about the color of the carpet in the doctor's office. It has a way of focusing your mind. Pain or suffering helps us focus on what really matters about as much as anything can possibly do. Vance Havner once said, and I love this, "When you're up to your neck in alligators, you aren't interested in a symposium on how to drain the swamp. It's a little too late for that." So, one of my favorite movies It's a love movie with theology and all sorts of stuff like that. One of my favorite movies ever is the movie Shadowlands. It stars Anthony Hopkins and Deborah Winger. Anthony Hopkins plays C.S. Lewis, the great theologian. And it's a beautiful story about the love story that happened between the two of them. At the age of 59, he married this longtime bachelor, married for the first time, David Mongresham, an American who was 16 years younger than him, divorced, a Jew, and an atheist. But she had come to Christ by reading his books. And when they were married, she had been diagnosed with cancer, and they even called their wedding a deathbed wedding. But she recovered for a while and lived fairly normally for about 4 years before she died. And after she died, he wrote a book called A Grief Observed, describing what he went through in his suffering and his agony while watching her die. Earlier, he had written a book called The Problem of Pain before he ever even met her, in which he had addressed this subject theologically and mentally. And now he's writing A Grief Observed, which he is describing the subject that he is going through. It's not just something theoretical anymore. It's what's actually happened to his life. And in one of the writings, he made the famous comment, pain insists upon being attended to. God whispers to us in our pleasures, speaks in our consciences, but shouts in our pains. It is his megaphone to rouse a deaf world. Haven't you found that to be true? Haven't you found that to be true, that God shouts sort of through a megaphone to you in your pain? Oh, you may still hear his still small voice and his whisper in your pleasures and in your everyday life, but when you're going through pain and suffering, it focuses your mind and you hear him like no other time. He said in the second book, A Grief Observed, pain removes the veil. It plants the flag of truth within the fortress of a rebel soul. In other words, when things are going great in our lives, we tend to major on the minors. It's only when pain comes and that veil is removed that God gets our full attention. Suffering makes us focus on the real issues of life and death. Paul said something else to the Corinthians. He said, one of the purposes of our pain and suffering is to show us we can't always help ourselves. We expected to die, but as a result, we stopped relying on ourselves and learned to rely on God who raises us. Hey, I've been there. I'd be willing to bet there are a lot of you that have been too. This contains a great statement in verse 9 behind the purpose in suffering. This happened so that we would stop relying on ourselves and learn to rely on God. And the reason why God allowed him to reach that point of total desperation was to teach him not to rely on his own strength. You know, people often say God helps those who help themselves. Wrong. 100% wrong. Even to the degree that it is absolutely the opposite. The Bible not only does not say that anywhere or imply that anywhere, the Bible actually teaches that God helps the helpless. It was when Paul was going through an experience, in his own words, that was beyond his ability to endure and that he thought he was going to die, that he stopped relying on himself and he started relying on God. There was nothing he could do about it on his own. You think Paul wouldn't have helped himself if he could have? Of course. It was when he was going through an experience beyond his ability to endure that he learned just how helpless he was. My life verse, the one I've told you about many times, my life verse that I chose in my 20s expresses this very, very truth. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. And lean not on your own understanding. My understanding is limited at best. Some days it's almost at zero. But his isn't. You won't truly be able to fully trust in the Lord until you have learned you cannot lean on your own understanding. And that's exactly what Paul said in this text. You know, I was watching a TV show one time about rescuing people, and it had all kinds of different rescue things, but it was talking about rescuing drowning people. And it said, if you're ever trying to rescue a drowning person, you have to delay going in. Let's say somebody's out in the Gulf or somebody's in a pool. It said you have to delay going in until they have quit fighting, completely quit fighting. And as hard a thing as that is to do, you have to let them come to the end of themselves till their strength is almost gone. You say, well, that doesn't make sense. Shouldn't I swim out and get them as soon as possible? But no, a drowning man can be dangerous because he has the strength to kick and to fight and panic and drown both of you. And it has happened many, many times. It's only when that person reaches the end of their strength and give up that they can then be rescued. It's only when he is utterly exhausted and ceases to make the slightest effort to save himself that somebody else can save him. And I couldn't help but think as I was watching that and then preparing this lesson how much alike that is with AA's first two of the 12 steps. The first two is you have to admit you're powerless over alcohol or drugs and that your lives have become unmanageable. You are powerless to help yourself. And the second is you have to believe that a power greater than yourself can help you. That is exactly what Paul is saying in these words. I thought I was going to die. I couldn't endure another bit, but God allowed this to happen so that I would no longer rely on myself. I admitted that I couldn't fix it myself and would cause me to completely trust in him. You see, before suffering or affliction comes into your life, you may truly be tempted to swell up and boast, I can handle anything. I've heard people do that. I'm strong, I'm tough, I can handle anything. When you go through the pain of adversity and reach the end of your strength and have to admit, no, I can't. Lord, I'm drowning. I'm going down for the last time. And Lord, if you don't get me, I'm a goner. There have been many attempts by hurting people to answer the question, why do bad things happen to good people? About 30 years ago, there was a popular book that was a number one bestseller by Rabbi Harold Kushner. He's a gentleman, he's a scholar, but his answer to the question in the book left me quite flat. He basically says that God is a good God, but that God is powerless to help us out. So I'll just put it in his own words. This is a quote from the book. Even God has a hard time keeping chaos in check. God is a God of justice and not of power. Well, my Bible tells me that God is a God of justice, but that he's also a God of power as well. In fact, we call him God Almighty. the omnipotent ruler of the universe, and we read multiple passages in the New Testament that say nothing is impossible with God. God may have allowed you to go through some tough times in the past because it's only when you learn to trust Him and not trust yourself that you get it. And then Paul said something else. He said, sometimes we go through our pain and suffering to teach us all we need the help of others. We can't do it by ourselves. We can't do it without God, but we also need the help of others. Because you see, others were praying for us too, he says. And then there were many people who were giving thanks because God has graciously answered so many prayers. There is power in prayer. Let me just tell you, when we walk in here on Sunday morning and we put the names of those people on the screen who need our prayers, and we all bow individually in a moment of silent prayer, just ourselves, and we pray for those people, and then our leader, one of our shepherds, prays for them as well, there's power in that. I believe that. I believe there has been healing that has come from that. I can't fully explain it all. I just know what the Bible says, and I believe it. Paul gave glory to God for delivering him. And he said, as you help us by your prayers. That's a pretty important and. We should trust God alone, but we need another resource as well. We need the help of God's people in the church. God never, ever intended for us to be Lone Ranger Christians out there toughing it out on our own. Today, there are some people, and you've met them just as well as I have, who say they love God and they love Jesus, they just don't care for the church. That, my friends, is an incredible contradiction. It's like saying you love swimming, but you don't like water. It's like saying you love to eat, but you don't like food. I mean, the church isn't perfect. But it is the body of Christ and the family of God here on earth. It's God's only show in town. And I'm not talking about a cold, legalistic, formal churchianity. I'm talking about God's people who love one another and pray for each other. Paul said, God delivered me, but I couldn't have made it without your prayers helping me too. Wow. As a church, one reason we exist is to carry each other's burdens. And in that way, we help fulfill the law of Christ. The law of Christ is what? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. You remember? The lawyer asked Jesus, what's the most important commandment? That's what he said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, love your neighbor as yourself. How do you fulfill the law of Christ? You carry each other's burdens. That's how you show you love God and how you love your neighbor. We're not perfect, but we're all holding on to each other, sustaining each other. I need you, and you need me. And if you don't realize you have that need, you better get that realization first. I don't know how many of you have seen. I've witnessed them. It's unbelievable. The mighty redwoods and sequoias out in California. How many of you have been there and seen those? It's magnificent. They grow to be hundreds of feet tall. But here's what you notice. You'll never see one standing alone. Never. And the reason for that is the roots of a redwood are so shallow, it could never stand alone without falling or being blown over. But beneath the surface of the forest, the roots of redwood trees intertwine with each other and support each other and hold them all up together in group, even as they grow stronger and mightier. That's the image I would have for you of God's family, the church. We're the same way. I need you to help me stand, and I will help you stand, and we need each other, and we especially need each other when we are hurting. And that's what Paul is saying in this glorious text. And then he said something else. He said, our suffering prepares us to help other people who struggle. You're helping us by praying for us, then many people will give thanks because God has graciously answered so many prayers for our safety. Since Paul was a recovering struggler, his words of God's deliverance helped others as well. He knew the story of deliverance would spread among the believers because he wrote, many will give thanks because of the favor that God has granted me. You see, God has a school for his children. It's called the University of Adversity. The tuition is rather high, and the courses are even tougher than calculus or organic chemistry. And the time and the places of the courses aren't even announced in advance. You just wake up one day in the middle of your pain and you realize you're enrolled in the class. And the class roll, man, you should see the roll on the wall at the University of Adversity. Abraham and Moses and Job and Hannah and David and Esther and Jeremiah. And actually, Job took the course several times. And Peter and Stephen and thousands of others who suffered and suffered and suffered and thought they were going to die. And some of them did. And their struggles give strength to those of us who are now taking the same courses in the same university. You don't ever graduate until you get to heaven. You just get to keep taking more and more graduate courses over a wide range of topics. But remember, the more degrees you have, the more you are able to help other people. Before, a few years ago, somebody came to me who had depression. I just said to them the absolute wrong thing to say. Well, suck it up. I was like my football coach in high school. Well, suck it up. Get up. You'll be better. Come on. Get your act together. Go through the course. You don't say that. You say something totally different once you've been through the course. When someone now faces open heart surgery, every time I call them and I try to explain what my experience was and how you go through it, I've been through that course. And so others who are going to go through it need to kind of understand what they may be facing. Somebody's family faces divorce. I've gone through that course. Somebody else's family faces whether to turn off the button on a parent's life support machine. I took that course. I remember it so vividly, sitting in a chair 13 years ago, head down, praying, begging God for the right answer. All of these courses are designed to not only help us, but to help us to help others when they go through it. Part of the point. Did you lose a child? Lose a job? Lose your mate? Lose your mind? Instead of being resentful about that, why don't you use your experience to help others who are facing the same thing? I want to leave you this morning with one takeaway truth. Every scar tells a story. Every single scar tells a story. When I was about 7 or 8 years old, I was running in my grandmother's backyard in Cowan, Tennessee. She had told me I do not know how many times to stop. I just kept doing it. I ran smack face first into a barbed wire, and I have a little scar right here, and you talk to me closer up, you've seen it. It's right here. They put 6 inches in my, 6 inches, they put six, six stitches right there, and it's now 60-something years, 61 years later, and you can still see it. It's a scar. It tells a story. It tells a story of a stupid kid not obeying his parents. Let me rephrase that, if I may. It's a story of a stupid kid not obeying his parents. And I pay for that scar, for that story. I have a scar, right, a little place right here on my finger that in high school football infected, grew up like this. I mean, literally like this. It was infected, it was red, it was swollen, it had pus coming out of it. And my coach, Coach Dozier, looked at me and said, "You're going to play tonight, aren't you?" And I did. And that scar is still there as a result of it not being treated. I have, across my chest, a scar, down this arm a scar, and down both legs a scar from open heart surgery. You have joined the zipper club with me, Mr. Jacobson. Every scar tells a story. Think about your scars. And by the way, all scars are not visible. Some scars aren't on the body, some are on the heart. Some are in the mind. Think about your scars. Your scars have stories too. It might have been a surgery or an injury or an accident or a war wound. You should be proud of your scars because they prove you not only have suffered, but you survived. You survived. To paraphrase what Paul was really trying to communicate, he said, "I have suffered, I have scars, I have survived, and now I have a story to tell you about God's deliverance." Your scars should tell you the same thing. You've suffered and you will suffer again. And sometimes, like with Paul, there are reasons behind that suffering and lessons for you to learn. And the same God who delivered you before and who delivered Paul will deliver you again. So the biggest question about suffering is not why, but what. What am I going to do in response to my suffering or my pain? And you have a choice. You have a choice in the matter. When pain comes, some people grumble. Some people gripe. Some people groan. Some people grieve. Some people grunt and growl. But there are other people who, like Paul, experience grace and grow. That's what this wondrous text in 2 Corinthians is all about. Making the right choice when we're in pain or suffering. And being sure that we grow in grace and become victorious overcomers. And you can do it by the power of God and through His help. No matter who you are, you can do it. That's what we do when bad things happen to God's people.